I cleared my throat and reached for the door handle. When I entered the corridor leading back to the elevators, I tried not to notice the high-powered corporate types rushing here and there around me. Everyone looked so professional and put together. I felt like a bumpkin by comparison. Sure, I'd owned my own business for several years, but I'd never had the kind of job where so much money was on the line. And it wasn't just money. My mother's health depended on what happened today. If I couldn't convince these executives to buy this biomedical printing technology at top dollar, all of my mother's treatment plans might as well be written in disappearing ink. As I left the vaulted atrium to enter one of the high-speed mirrored elevators, I cleared my throat for what seemed like the millionth time. The air in this building was stuffy. I missed the fresh, clean air of the Wolf Branch Trail behind my mother's house. The sound of trickling water from the winter-slowed French Broad River wandering past the Blue Ridge Parkway not far away. If I closed my eyes, I could almost replace the ding of each floor whizzing by with the shirring sound of the dried leaves still clinging to some of the trees deep in the Nantahala forest.
"Sir?"
I snapped my eyes open to see two women looking at me expectantly.
"Isn't this the floor you wanted?"
Yes, sorry. I flashed an apologetic smile before jumping through the closing doors just in time. When I looked up, three men in suits stood in an elegant lobby, staring at me. Even the young female receptionist blinked at me from her spot behind a sleek, brushed metal launch pad. Well, more likely it was a desk, but there were curves and monitors, buttons and switches. Her headset looked like something that would be on the newest iteration of Star Trek.
"May I help you?"
she asked with the precise raise of a perfectly plucked eyebrow. I looked back over my shoulder at the executives as I passed them.
I'm here to see
that asshole. That's what I'd been about to say because that's how we always referred to him at home. Never by name. My mother refused to allow anyone to even speak it in her presence. He was always just that asshole. And of course now, when I needed to actually remember his name, I totally blanked. Oh, God. The receptionist stared at me, waiting for me to speak, which made my brain seize up even more.
The head guy, I stammered. The big guy, not tall, I mean in charge, well, maybe he's also, I think his name is,
I felt my face heat and my pits begin to sweat, his name is Slim Shady? No, asshole, 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 my brain chanted. My stomach dropped, and I felt my throat dry up. I'd seen a photograph of the CEO and wondered if describing him would help. Tall, dark, and handsome, I squeaked. Little intimidating, scowly, but in an oh-my-God kind of way. Shut up, shut up! Before I had the chance to describe the tiny mole below the edge of the man's lip, the barest hint of a laugh line appeared next to one of the receptionist's eyes. Might it be Mr. Grange himself? Wellington Archibald Grange the Third. The scariest motherfucker to ever be considered a corporate raider. The man my mother despised with every ounce of her disease-riddled body. The man who wanted to gobble up my mother's life work like it was a generic box of brand cereal and shit out a shoddy version of it to sick people in need at a staggering upcharge. "That's the one," I said, straightening up and trying to put on a brave face. "Conor Newell, here to see Wells Grange. Please,